were meant to live in clover. But they are such a chosen few. Clover being green is something I've never seen. 'Cause I was born to be blue. When there's a yellow moon above me.
Hey, Giovanni, oh, am I bothering you?
No, not at all. Come in.
Okay, what are you doing?
Reviewing papers, you know, for change.
You know, we're doing this presentation for the students at for the young faculty at ENAR, and they're very, very interested in the process by which journals make their decisions, and I think they would really be fascinated by what goes on in, you know, the thinking of biometrics editors. So what sort of process are you using for that paper right there?
Oh, I just wanted to show you this because we care a lot about the review process, and in particular about junior investigators. We want to make sure that the process is completely unbiased as to age, the initial affiliation of origin, and all of these different factors. Actually, we even have special frequentist devices to guarantee that this process is completely free of any biases.
Well, I think they would be delighted to hear that you're not very concerned about academic status and institution, things like
Absolutely.
That. So what sort of procedures does biometrics use?
Well, you know, we have this special frequentist device. It's blue. And based on this, you can assign a paper to any one of six categories, which could be rejected, 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 or accepted with tons of revisions.
That is very interesting. Could you talk about how the actual content of the paper plays a role in your decision?
Well, see, that's part of the whole bias deal because, you know, we humans, and there was a nice article in Science about this recently, as soon as we get new information, we tend to update. And as soon as we update, we are Bayesian and we're biased. So the minute you read the abstract of a paper, you cannot read the second page in an unbiased way.
Huh.
So, you know, this, for example, this is a paper that is 56 pages long, a very profound attack at this problem. Would you read it to evaluate? By the time you're on page 54, I mean, you're totally biased about page 55. So that's where the blue approach comes in. You know, you just have to use the appropriately randomization device. Like, if you look at this one, I mean, you might have seen in other people's offices those sort of cubicle dice that with little numbers carved in. Those are terribly biased because by carving, you're actually effectively each edge has a different weight. And so, you know, you throw it and it always comes out the same side or almost. While with this approach, which is a perfectly round, perfectly polished dice, we don't have any danger of that sort.
So, could you show the attendees of this workshop exactly how this works?
Sure. See, it has to have a long desk, so you move the stuff out of the way, you put your paper in position, and off you go. It has to bounce off of the paper, and then you look at it. Which category did I say the accept with major revision was?
Yeah, you didn't say what number it was. I think it was.
I forgot. I must have it written someplace. Quite remember now.
Oh.
Hey, Tom.
Hey, Steve. Hi.
Listen, do you have a few minutes?
I've got a few minutes.
You know, we're doing a little instructional series of interviews with illustrious members of the statistical community that might have wisdom to share with the attendees of an ENAR workshop that I think you're participating in. And I think they would be very interested in sort of the inside story of how a JASA editor makes the decisions and what sort of factors are weighed. And I was wondering if you could just, you know, talk to us about it for a minute.
Well, I appreciate that opportunity because in the presentation I gave, I really didn't focus on that aspect. And so I think it would be helpful.
So Why don't you talk about, I think we've talked to some of the other editors. JASA is a particularly busy journal, we know. And I in particular, would be very interested to know exactly how you manage that huge volume of papers and make the sort of nuanced and difficult judgments that you have to make in such a high-stakes journal.
Well, Steve, you know, you're right. There are a lot of submissions. And if this were 20 years ago, you would see on my desk and behind me, and probably all over this office, just piles of manuscripts. It's all electronic now, but it, and therefore you don't see it, but it doesn't in any way reduce the burden of the editor in making decisions and crafting reports to authors. And if you'd like, setting a philosophy for the journal.
So, well, I, you know, that's all nice, and they hear that, but what do you actually do? I mean, you know, if you have 30 manuscripts on your desk, what sort of standards do you apply to them? How much time do you spend reading them? What do you do with the what do you do with the reviews that come in?
Well, as you know, there's about a 25% acceptance rate ultimately, and so I have to keep that in mind. I also have to keep in mind that I have other things that I need to do. Academic things. I also like sailing. I like traveling, I like going to plays and concerts. There are a lot of things I enjoy, and I have to make sure to control the amount of time I spend being JASA editor. And so I've decided early on when I was editor that I would have to be very efficient and make some trade-offs so that in fact I could get this job done in an expeditious manner.
So can you give us an example?
I can give you an example. In fact, I'll give you the principal theme and the principal approach. As you may know, and if not, I can let you know, I've actually published on a lot of different things in a lot of different contexts. And so my primary method of deciding on a manuscript's merit is to check references. What I do is I want to see, at least in those areas where I've worked, whether or not my work is properly cited. And more importantly, or at least equally important, I want to make sure that intervening references that have come between my seminal work and the current moment don't get in the way of the principal message that is needed.
Have you, that's very interesting. Have you found an area where you find that contributors write papers in any areas where you haven't published?
You know, I have. I agree that it's not in very many areas, but there have been some. And there are somewhat emerging fields that JASA generally isn't very interested in. We'd like to, if you'd like, sort of not occupy the cutting edge, but be right behind that with solid citizen statistical work.
Could you give us a few examples of what these emerging fields are that JASA isn't quite ready to dive into?
Well, off the top of my head, certainly the whole field of genomics. Environmental risk, the statistical aspects. Dimension reduction in general. Modern methods of smoothing data and smoothing models. Those are, you know, areas that I have published very little in, and it's very difficult to imagine JASA wanting to take the lead on these.
I want to go back to something you mentioned before about the reference checking, and ask if you could elaborate on your procedures or philosophy there.
Well, I had the strategic approach in the sense of how I wanted to do it, but I was finding it still took far more time than I was willing to devote. So I actually had a graduate student program, a little R program, and had the editorial assistant scan articles and extract references so that I can now compute, really at the push of a button, the weighted kappa statistic on the correlation between the reference citations and my work, and have a way to prioritize the quality and acceptability of a manuscript. Now I realize, Steve, I know that you're sort of thinking this, and I want you to know that I understand that there's an efficiency and effectiveness trade-off here. There is no free lunch. You cannot have everything about everything, but I have found that you can actually get a reasonably good reduced price lunch with this approach.
Have you ever had, could you talk about the role that external reviews play?
Well, I mean, they're vital. they're vital. You've got to send something back to the authors. And it's also true that involving the community in this review process makes everyone feel part of the whole and part of our discipline. So what I do, and it's very helpful and very effective, is I use the associate editor's input, referee's input, as a way to communicate my decision. Authors read these reviews, they get great insights and hints. They don't know that underneath the system, essentially, is weighted capital.
So what would be the implications of that for your advice for young researchers in deciding what and where they should submit?
Well, I'm surely not going to reveal the R code of my weighted kappa, but in that spirit, and with the idea that many editors operate at least very similarly to me, I think the best strategy is to look at the current editors of various journals publications, compute your own version of a weighted kappa, try to get some guess on what might be going on, and then submit to the journal where the correlation is the highest.
Well, Tom, I know you have a sailing appointment at 1, so I don't want to take up any of your time. So I really want to thank you on behalf of the young researchers of ENAR for sharing this wisdom today. I think this is going to be of extraordinary use in their careers.
Well, Steve, it's been a pleasure, and I hope it's been helpful. I actually have to get off to my sailmaker now.
Okay.
Hi, Dr. Goodman.
Hi, Moni. How are you?
Very good.
I had an appointment with Scott. Is he around?
Let me double check there.
See
you. He says
oh,
15 minutes.
Oh, 15. Oh, thank you. Well, that's very nice of him.
Hello.
I have Dr. Goodman here to see you.
Come on in, Steve.
Hey, how are you?
I'm great. How are you doing?
I'm coming in today because remember I talked to you about that ENAR video. Talk about the issue of promotion. I thought there was really no one better around here to talk about this than you, because you spend a lot of your time doing this. And I was wondering if you'd be willing to talk to us today about it.
Sure, Steve. You know, promotion is one of the most important things that young faculty think about, and I'd be delighted to tell you what I know about it.
Great. Now, I think one of the things that concerns young investigators the most is the uncertainty. They don't really know what's expected of them. They feel it might be a bit capricious or unfair. They don't know exactly how many papers they should be publishing, where they should be publishing, what they should be teaching. Is there any guidance you can give them from your experience about how they should be thinking about that?
You know, I know junior faculty, you know, assume the worst about the promotion process, but actually chairs of biostatistics departments across the country have put a lot of time into thinking through the promotion process and actually to trying to simplify it and make it more consistent across the many diverse institutions at which biostatistics departments live. And we've actually spent quite a bit of time working with each other to try to create a system that gives young faculty exactly what they deserve.
Is that something, is it secret, or is it something that you can show us?
Well, you might think it is secret, but it isn't actually. It's something that's available, and I'd be delighted to tell you about it. In fact, I have several junior faculty in my department. I think we have 8 now, and several of them have been promoted recently. And I'm working on a couple of other cases, and I actually have over here exactly what the system is.
Oh, well, that would be great. So you show us the techniques you use.
I'd be delighted. Let me show you, Steve.
Actually, some may be surprised by this, but what we have is a promotion score.
You mean an equation?
It's a simple logistic regression. So let me just show you. We have the log of the odds of being promoted, and certainly all the junior biostatisticians know what an odds of promotion is. And there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, only 6 variables that we use in this equation that's been developed by the chairs from departments across the country. Shall I take them?
I think that would be extraordinarily valuable.
So the first one is what most people think is a very important variable, and it's here first for that reason, and that is the number of articles that you publish. And we put a lot of weight on articles, and in fact, the coefficient for this is a positive 0.01. So for each additional article that you publish, you get a 1% increase in your odds of promotion. So somebody who's published 50 articles has a 0.5 or roughly a 50% increase in their odds of being promoted. And then, of course, courses taught is important, and all of the chairs felt that we have to give this due recognition. So for each additional course that you teach a year, we increase your promotion, again, by a 0.01. So if you teach 4 courses in a year, then that's as good as teaching, as good as publishing 4 papers. And then there are the student ratings. You know, it used to be that we just focused on courses taught, but we've increasingly recognized that students should play a role in the promotion process. And actually, so we have a coefficient on this one of minus 0.05. You know, actually, we found that those faculty whose students rate them as being excellent are probably wasting a lot of time that could otherwise be spent on some of these more important things. And so we don't want too much time being spent polishing courses and dealing with sort of individual student concerns, so that that actually doesn't help the promotion very much, and it gets a negative coefficient, unfortunately. Then there's papers refereed each year. You know, we do want to encourage our faculty to spend some time working on service to the community, but I think this is probably pretty well known among faculty that there's also a price to be paid for spending too much time refereeing. You know, I'm an editor of a journal as well, and the truth is that the referees' reports, they don't play very much role in whether papers get published anyway. And so I don't want my faculty, and the other chairs don't want their faculty spending too much time on this. And so again, we have to have a negative coefficient on that. And then, of course, very important to the success of a faculty member is faculty service. And you know, there are lots of things that happen in a department like this one, or a department, the other universities, where it has to be done by faculty, and junior faculty really have to play a large role. So often something will come up. You know, so I'm sitting here talking to you now, and I need to have something done. In fact, I really have to have a manuscript copied in the library. I've been thinking about a problem just before you came in, and so what I usually do is I just go over here and call a junior faculty member. And in order to really keep track of how effective faculty members are at responding to my needs, I often start a stopwatch to see how long it takes. And I'm just going to call somebody. Hey, Francesca, how are you? Look, I need a paper copy. You know that paper you and I were discussing this morning? Could you get me a copy and send it up as soon as possible, please? Oh, great. Thanks very much. Bye-bye. So we'll see how long it takes Francesca to get it. But what we do is we keep the faculty service score, and this actually is something between 0 to 100%. And 100% service is almost instantaneous reaction to the requests made by the chair. And actually, this gets a coefficient of a 1.0. Your chances of promotion actually are substantially increased by being responsive to chair and other senior faculty demands on junior faculty. And then there's one more variable. It's the ICF. We've called it the ICF among the chairs. This is the institutional correction factor. And we recognize that there are differences between institutions in how people are promoted. And this actually gets quite a substantial minus 1.0 coefficient. And let me see, the variable institutional correction factor takes the value 1 if you're from Harvard University, and zero if you are not.
So, Steve, that's really it. It's six variables. Each faculty member has a value for these blue X's, and we just multiply those by these coefficients, which have been derived by the chairs of the various departments, and then we can predict whether or not you're being promoted. Oh, well, there's one other thing I forgot. You need an intercept here, yeah. So there's also an intercept, which is Venus 1.0 for assistant to associate professor, and minus 3.0 for associate to full professor.
Well, I think that the attendees at this workshop will find this to be extraordinarily illuminating, if not career-changing. Now, do you think, I know that this is confidential, it's not something that you typically do, but do you think it would be possible for us to show it in action, that is to show a case study, to use anybody's file to show how you do it? I mean, you do say that this is transparent and unbiased. So I think they'd like to see how exactly you apply this.
Sure, it's no problem. So let's quickly go through it with a little case study. Actually, you know, we just promoted someone a couple of months ago, and as I recall, these five variables, their score was a total of 0.9, and the real strength of that candidate was the number of articles. I have it here. Yeah, here's the CV. Okay, so let's take a look. So there are four papers of chance. There's three in the American Statistician. Well, here's a series of 17 papers in the footnotes in mathematical statistics. And then, well, this was the strength. I mean, this person had a weekly article in the MIT Alumni Bulletin. So, I mean, the total number of papers was something like 70 here. And you can see then that that just pushed them right over the top. Promotion was a slam dunk for this guy.
Well, that I think that probably opened a lot of eyes. Any other files that you can share with us that might have different nuance?
It's amazing you came today because actually, you know, as chair, I'm always thinking about promoting the younger faculty, and I was in the process when you came in of working through a case. Actually, that person was quite similar in terms of their variables. I think their total was also 0.9. We can get their article. I haven't really done it yet, but let's take a look. Oh, boy. Well, not nearly as strong, unfortunately, but there are, let's see, three articles in Biometrica. We have a two JASA papers. We have two papers this year in the Annals of Statistics, and three papers in Biostatistics. I think that's 10. So we had 0.9 and 10 times 0.01. So this is a person who looks like their sum is around zero. So the log odds of promotion is zero, so the probability of promotion is 50%.
Huh, so it's like a flip of a coin, huh?
That's actually how we do it. So in a 50% case, do you want to do it now?
Well, is this something that you feel comfortable showing to the...
We got to do it sometime, and there's as much chance of it being a success as a failure. Why don't we do it?
Okay, well, let's see what happens. What's the verdict?
I didn't get promoted.
Hello, Keith West. Nice to meet you. Dr. Bormi?
Bahrami. Yeah.
Bahrami, yeah, that's what I said, Dr. Bormi.
Yeah,
glad to meet you. Please
thank
come
you,
in.
Thank you.
Why don't you have a seat? So, I've heard much about your work in the past, and it really is a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you, it's my honor.
I have been looking forward to exchanging views about this project that we have been carrying out in Nepal. And Let me give you some background as to why I've asked to meet with you. We have this project in Nepal that we have been carrying out for a while, and now are ready to launch a trial to look at the effects of vitamin A in reducing not only child mortality, but the way that vitamin A may do it by interacting at the molecular level, by influencing retinoic acid receptors and retinoid X receptors within the genome that can affect the retinoic acid response elements that we call RARE in terms of affecting gene transcription, protein metabolism, immunity, and the subsequent ability of children to withstand the insult of infection. And we're going to look at this in terms of a randomized community trial in Nepal amongst a population of children that tend to be vitamin A deficient. Numitin orshange porichai koridi Nepal bacha kub malnourished and needing vitamin A. Numitin orshange porichai koridi utsukushisha shinki wa yoko arimasen deshita atau akoni vitamin A. Cha ekon kub rarely siapa janen rare. Ibu mau pergi kemana? Shashinki wa yoko arimasen deshita. Vitamin A. Ibu mau pergi kemana hari ini? Jam sukoshi arimaska untuk kaj kub rare. Karena ami wa karimasen deshita. Kokon watashi wa sho bahasa boti pari. Jam waktu bersama sama atau akani trial. So the question I have for you is, can the sample size for this trial possibly be the same when looking at differences in retinoic acid response elements as it is for differences in child mortality? Dr. Parmi, am I clear?
Yeah, perfect, that's perfect. Let me make sure that I understood it correctly. You're saying it's vitamin A?
Yes.
It's rare?
Right.
And it's trial?
Exactly.
And sample size?
You've got it.
Yeah. Okay. Thus, I think, Dr. Vest, your study has a longitudinal component, which is a correlation complex. And in order to handle it, I think we should use generalized estimation equation. And in order to calculate sample size for that, I need you to tell me what's the power and the standard effect size that you're aiming at. Let's see, I hope, Dr. Kate. اون چیزی که من فهمیدم از پرتوپلاهی که شما گفتید این بود که شما مطالعاتون یه مطالعه طولیه که در اصل یه جزء همبستگی داره. بسیار خوب دکتر بس، در اصل اون چیزی که من فهمیدم از اون پرتوپلاهی که شما فرمودید این است که شما مطالعاتون یک جزء طولی داره که در اصل این یک جزء همبستگی درش نهفته است و برای اینکه ما اینا آنالیزش کنیم در اصل احتیاج به معادله تخمین عمومی دادن برای اینکه من بتونم حجم سمپل سایز رو با استفاده از این معادله تخمین عمومی حساب کنم احتیاج دارم به اینکه شما به من دو چیز رو بگید، یکی پاور استادی و یکی هم اندازه خطایی که شما از من میخواد.
Power and sample size.
And effect size.
And effect size.
Yes. Okay, 300.
300?
Eureka.
Eureka.
There you go. Oh my god. ahead.
Well, this has been a real eye-opener and a real learning experience for me, Dr. Bahrami. I appreciate you coming like this.
You're welcome. Thank you very much, Dr. Ratz. I also appreciate, I realize that all I've heard about you was correct. It was an honor to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Well, your reputation preceded you, and I tell you, this has been a tremendous
session. Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, it's been great. Thank you very much.
The best wishes for you.
Thank you, and we'll see you. Next time I have a statistical question, you can count on me coming after you and finding
you. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I appreciate it.
All the best now.
I don't believe in fretting and grieving. Why mess around with strife? I guess I was cut out to step and strut out. Give me the simple life. It must be pleasant dining on pheasant using the proper knife. I want tomatoes and mashed potatoes. Give me the simple life. Cottage small is all I'm after, one that's spacious and wide. A heart that rings with joy and laughter with the ones you love inside. You take the high road, I'll take the low road, free from all care and strife. Sounds corny and seedy, but yes indeedy, give me the simple life.